Hi guys, today our inspiration is Vincent Van Gogh. And I love this painting. This is the one white iris. Well, they don't call it that, they just call it iris. But you'll see in this video that we're going to watch, you'll see the iris garden has one white iris. And that, I think, is a self-portrait in a way, because he considered himself different than everyone else, and he was. I just want to tell you just a few things about him that maybe we don't know, and then we're going to show you a beautiful film of his work. He was born in Holland to a upper middle class family, and his father was a minister. His mother encouraged him to draw early on. He was a quiet, sensitive child. He worked as he got older. He was mostly taught at home, and he worked as a with his brother in an art dealership, and then he worked in a bookstore, but that was about it. And when he was 29 or something, he wanted to become a minister. So he went to Brussels and worked with coal miners. And he gave up his apartment. He was with a church. His father was a Protestant minister, and he gave his apartment to some homeless man, and he went to live in a shack and slept on straw, and he was just giving everything away, and he was living kind of like not very healthy. And so when his time came to stay, they rejected him. They said he's too different than everybody else. So his brother suggested he become an artist, and he went to Belgium and enrolled. He was against, you know, regular education, but he wanted to learn to paint. So he went to Brussels, and he spent some time getting a classical education and drawing figures and painting, learning things, classical training, color theory, composition, and then, see, what was that? That was like, he was like 82, 83, something like that. And he worked really hard on his own. He did a lot of drawings. He was very interested after being with the coal miners, ministering to the coal miners. He really wanted to paint peasants and people working. It was the coal mining place was so sad. And I think he was sort of a social justice person. He wanted to make a difference. And so he was always very religious. A lot of his paintings are symbolic, religious symbols. And he was tormented. He was a tormented artist, which is a cliche, but he really was a tormented artist, where insanity and genius meet, they say. So he did a lot on his own, a lot of drawings. In 1885, he did his first what they call masterpiece, and it was called The Potato Eaters, and it's these peasants sitting around their table eating their, like, one potato or whatever. Very, very sad time and people. And he just did a lot of drawings that captured the spirit of the working, the sadness of it all. And he ended up in Paris with his brother. His paintings were very realistic in the beginning. His drawings were very well rendered. He learned a lot about composition. But his brother told him, "We can't sell your paintings because they're too dreary. They're very dark." And so while he was in Paris, he met Seurat and Paul Signac. He was a pointillist, and they were investigating color theories. Where if you put two complementary colors next to each other, which I try to talk to you about all the time, complementary color schemes are very good because they create color vibration. So they were putting little dots of pink next to dots of green to get this color vibration, and I can see that influenced Van Gogh's work that he did right after that. Remember, you'll see a lot of these in the paintings where you have to see every brushstroke. In fact, they even said at one time, you just put the paint right out of the tube. Just put it right on, thick and pure. So it was a lot of this juxtaposition of pure color, which creates color vibration. And as you know, he had an emotional, mental problem most of his life. From the time he was 20, I think, he was having trouble with people that he was meet. He had three horrible relationships with women that all rejected him. So he didn't succeed in that either. What I'm going to tell you about, the best thing is he had this revival. He painted only, in 10 years, he was only painting for 10 years. And he painted about 2,000 paintings, but then another 1,300 watercolors and drawings. And when he went to Provence, the last 2 years of his life, he went down there about 1888, and he died in 1890 at the age of 37. And he was so excited because the light was different, he was just inspired by everything he saw. And he was very working high productivity in short spurts, which is a sign of bipolar disease, which he's accused of having. He had so many diagnoses that we don't really know what he had. Some say he was manic depressive, schizophrenic, epileptic, depressed, definitely depressed, hallucinating. He was not in very good shape, but so interested in painting and seeing beauty. And one of the quotes that I sent you is that he said, if you love nature, you will see beauty everywhere. And so that's what he was like. He had this other side, his compassionate side, his excitement about beauty side, and just the tormented artist for sure. So, but he lightened up his palette after dealing with after meeting the pointillists. And so he added, you'll love this, he added cobalt blue, carmine, which would be opera or alizarin, and emerald green is phthalo green. So I'm so happy to see that. And they do show up in his paintings. He has a lot of complementary color scheme paintings. I guess that's it. I just wanted to tell you a little bit about him before we look at this film. It's really beautiful. You're going to like it. And when we come back, we will talk about our composition that we're going to be painting, and I'll show you a Van Gogh painting that's very much like the one that we're going to be painting. And so sit back and enjoy this beautiful song. Okay. Before we hear the song, I wanted to show you some of his early work to begin with. This is called The Miners, a drawing that he did when he was a missionary in Belgium. This is probably done in his art school days. Beautiful composition. Notice the horizontal structure lines, all the verticals, and the quadrant where the lady is in the right place. This is his masterpiece, The Potato Eaters, painted in 1885. He loved to do peasants. And this I included because it's a watercolor that he did in Provence on the Mediterranean. Notice the splotchiness of the blue. This is a Provence painting called Wheat Field with Cypress, and I love the clouds, the expressive clouds. Made me think of what we're doing. And this is a painting of olive trees outside of his hospital in San Romain. Notice the shadows are the same color, reflecting the color of the trees. This is called Landscape with Rain. And notice after he painted this very abstract landscape, he sliced the rain with a palette knife. And this is a painting in the last few months of his life. It's after Rembrandt, called The Raising of Lazarus. This is a painting I mentioned, The Iris. It's a big painting, 24 by 36, painted a few months before he died. And you see what I meant by the one white iris.
Starry, starry night, paint your palette blue and gray. Look out on a summer's day with eyes that know the darkness in my soul. Shadows on the hills, sketch the trees and the daffodils, catch the breeze and the winter chills in colors on the snowy linen land. Now I understand what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen now. Starry, starry night, flaming flowers that brightly blaze, swirling clouds in violet haze, reflecting Vincent's eyes of china blue, colors changing hue. Morning fields of amber grain, weathered faces lined, are soothed beneath the artist's loving hand. Now I understand what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen, for they could not love you, but still your love was true. And when no hope was left in sight on that starry, starry night, you took your life as lovers often do. But I could have told you, Vincent, this world was never meant for one as beautiful. Starry, starry night, portraits hung in empty halls, frameless heads on nameless walls, with eyes that watch the world and can't forget, like the strangers that you've met. The ragged men in ragged clothes, the silver thorn, a bloody rose, lie crushed and broken on the virgin snow. Now I think I know what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they're not listening still. Perhaps they never will.
Oh, that was great.
Yeah. I'm crying.
Very touching.
Very.
I know.
Yeah, I cry.
I forget them. Both.
I know. Notice the quote that I sent you with your link. It said, if you hear a voice, that's his quote. If you hear a voice that says, you cannot paint, you must paint. Oh. That will silence the voice. That the voice will be silent. That is what I've hammered home with you guys since the beginning. The right brain, the left brain. The right brain wants to paint, can paint, loves to paint. It's calling you. The left brain is saying, oh, you can't paint. But as soon always. as you start, it shuts up. So
yep.
I was excited. He knew all about it. So now let's take a look at this. On the screen, we have the painting that I'm going to demonstrate today. And next to it is the Van Gogh painting. On this picture, and I wanted to have it be your last one, And then I thought, well, you know, we haven't really talked about, I wanted to talk to different artists. I didn't plan to, but it sort of evolved that way. And I thought, well, maybe I can find something that Van Gogh did. I didn't really know about landscapes with flowers. I didn't think he had done any. So, and then I opened a book, and there it is, the first one I saw. So I said, well, I guess him, he can be it. Even if we have nothing but this one, that would be enough to get going. And then when we finally put them side by side, I want you to see the structure line, the way the painting is laid out. So we're just going to go across. So see this line right here comes right across like that, right there. This first big shape. Yeah. Then you go up. The next one is this one right here. It goes right across the top of the flowers, and then up here where he has the we have a mountain. After that, it's different. But still the light color here is about the same as the mountains, and then he just has a where we have clouds. He has a house. But it's pretty much the same. So mm-hmm. What I'm saying is that we talked about last week about structure lines, and when you start a painting, and he did this every time, his compositions are gorgeous. They're just gorgeous. And they may look messy and all that, but when you get back from a distance, they look very realistic. So you have any questions or anything before we start the demonstration? In watching the demonstration, we're looking for watercolor techniques that I've been talking about. And in this one, I show a little bit of lifting and a little bit of glazing, which I mentioned in the vegetable, a lot of glazing. But this one, okay, it starts off, number one technique, wet on wet. I wet the bottom, I dropped in color so it would bleed, purposely wanted it to bleed. I didn't want to paint it. I did not want to paint every flower. I don't want you to paint every flower. Make this your own. If it's Matisse or Cezanne or Renoir, whoever, paint it in your own style. So look for the wet on wet, and then look for splattering. I do a lot of splattering. I hit the brush with another brush and make it splatter. I think those are the two things. Oh, and then the clouds, painting the sky and then blotting off the clouds with a tissue. So I wanted to show you that, but then I was afraid I was going to lose my white, so I stopped it. But That's a form of lifting, lifting with the tissue or lifting off with the brush. So look for when I'm lifting with the brush and I'm splattering, okay? Hello. I'm going to paint a very fun and loose and juicy, wet on wet floral landscape. Two things, we're going to paint these flowers down here, just really fun, let them run around and all that. But I wasn't going to draw much, but I ended up drawing because I want to be sure, because it's such a beautiful composition, I want to be sure that the flowers are in the bottom half. You'll see on the composition the top flower. The top red flower is about right about there, which is about halfway. And I've got halfway on here. So that way, then I can divide things up. I noticed that the sky area was about 1/4. This is how you measure your sight for proportions. You go 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. So once you've decided one thing to the right proportion, then it's easier to do the rest of them. So I said I was going to do wet on wet, so let's start that right away. I'm going to just take a brush like this and put over all the flowers down here because I really want to have fun with the flowers. I want them to be, see if I can't paint them all in about 5 minutes. That would be my plan. And then we'll go on to the rest of the picture. Let's start right there. Start with some of the brightest colors. Opera pink is always a good one to start with. So let's just drop in some opera pink. And I'm looking at the picture, the landscape, 80% of the time. I know there's different pinks in here, but I'm starting off with this one so that I can let it drip around. Now maybe it's gonna dry, since it's so wet, it's going to dry 20% lighter, maybe 30% lighter. But so we put our first wash on a very gushy pink thing, maybe even a little brighter in here. And I know there's some red too. I'm gonna go back and put the red in. And keep some of these. I'm just keeping my eye. I've already done all the hard work by deciding about where things are gonna go. So now I can just be a little freer. I'm trying to save some whites and I've already forgotten them. We'll save them someplace else. Then I'm going to take some red and put in the darker shapes down here. These are darker red. Now remember, this is just an impression. Impression of a field of flowers. And just let it drop in. This might be a fun time to practice scattering. I haven't talked about that very much, but if you just take the brush and go like this, like that, right wet, you get some lovely things. There, it's not a bad start. Okay, let's put in some of the lovely green. I know this is pretty dark down in here, so maybe in here. Oh, that's awfully bright, I know. So let's put some yellow on top of it right away. We're mixing on the paper, remember? So there we go. Now I'm picking up the paint off the brush and moving it around. So just a few little places in here where it's going to be green. I can always go back after it dries and pull out a few details, but for now I'm really trying to make it very impressionistic. And leave a few whites somewhere. I will go back to the darker greens down here where it's very dark. Remember, you want to not have to go back too much. You want to be able to get some of the darks in while it's still wet. Maybe some of the lines. There we go. But down here seems to be the darkest area, huh? Oh, but I want to talk a little bit about lifting again. If I paint this whole area down here pretty dark, got a lot of green down here. Maybe I can put a little blue in to make it even darker in some places. Maybe it's going to dry lighter. Don't want to get some darks in here, maybe. Okay, there we go. Now that's about where the dark things are, as far as the flowers is concerned. Not too much more, I'm going to leave that alone. Okay, then you can lift, take all the paint out of the brush and kind of go while it's still wet. You can have such a good time lifting off little light lines like this. See, I go like that. You have to be sure that there's no paint on the brush. You just kind of go like this, especially in the dark areas. You can put a little white line like that. Maybe in here we'll put one. So you have lights and darks that tell the story of the foliage. There is some yellow, so let's put that in while it's still wet. In here, there's a few yellow things which I've kind of missed. Remember, I'm not going to be copying this especially. I'm using this as a jumping off place. Because if you start trying to copy it, you're going to lose the idea of spontaneity. But I do want some yellow. Maybe up here there'll be some yellow. See, there's a whole lot of yellow up in here in this area. But you don't really see the details of the flowers anymore. You just see kind of a blanket of yellow. And I love Van Gogh's quote that I sent you. Said that if you love nature, you will see beauty everywhere. This is certainly a case of that. I'm going to go back and put a few more dark flowers, put some darks in the flowers down here. There's some dark with an alizarin crimson down here in the darkest places. You see how they are a little bit darker down at the bottom. And this is the time to put them in. Not too many more. After that, there's not a lot of darks. So only put them where you see them. Okay. And then now I'm going to put a little bit more. No, now I'll go back to the green, but very pale green. In here. And then above the yellow thing. This might be fun to splatter. Let me put a little bit more yellow in here, in this whole area here. Put some yellow in there, over here too. Wherever you see yellow, and then maybe even up here a little bit. Yeah. And then splatter, splatter some green in there. There's a little bit of green on the brush, and go like this. Up in the yellow. There we go. See? And that really will make it look like the texture that we're seeing. Up in here. Maybe down in here too. There we go. Remember I said that texture and pattern were two of the seven visual elements? Well, this is definitely an opportunity to get texture in here. See how it's dripping? That's what I want. I don't want to clean it up. Well, let's go back now and do this section up here. More of a blue-green. We're going to leave this alone. We're going to let it do its own thing now. Try not to look at it. The rule is to do the best you can and move on. Now notice that some of this color is bouncing into here. So I'll put it up in here just a little bit. It's sort of a blue-green, but a gray, actually. It's more of a gray, isn't it? So, but it's got some green in it. But right in here is a separate piece that we need to keep separate from the flowers. So maybe a little more green in it. Make it slightly darker in places. There we go. We want it to be a border, where the flowers stop and the green grass begins. And then the mountain, grass on the side of the mountain, the bushes. Oh, I forgot, I just put the name of the parts, sorry. But this is the blue-green shape up here, a little bit darker. We know it's the bushes. Come down in here maybe just a little bit. There. And this is darker behind it. This is lighter. I'm just fooling around right now. Trying to make this slightly darker than the strip of grass here. This is important to keep this piece lighter than, darker than the flowers, but not too dark. Probably the best we can do. Maybe put a little bit more yellow in the green up here because it is grass. We have to show that it's different than the flowers. So that's your challenge. I'm lifting a little off right now, see? Because the grass is a little lighter in some places. Okay, well that's a case of doing the best I can and then move on. So now let's do, first I want to splatter a little bit of yellow in here. See how the flowers are peeking up into the grass? This would be a good chance to splatter again. Right along here. Not much is happening. Oh, there we go. That's a great way to get some feeling of petals, flowers in there. Lots of yellow flowers here. Definitely. Okay. I like this white here. It needs some white somewhere. Maybe it'll turn to yellow later. I think while it's still wet, I would like to lift a little bit over here. See, there's some little light area that I don't have. I've lost them. It'd be easy to lift them out now while it's still wet. There and there, and maybe down here. Right there. Lift a little. Maybe even back in here, I made it so yellow. Maybe I should make it lighter. A little lighter, because it's lighter lighter than the mountain. There we go. Just lifting just a little bit. There. I like it. There's probably one last thing before we move on. There's a lot of, some more pink flowers over here, really pretty. Kind of dark. Against the, I don't want to go back too much. But right in here, on along the edge of the picture, there's a lot of pink that I didn't put in. I think I'll put in now. There's a whole lot more flowers in here. There we go. So that's why I had to draw something in. You see, I'm not really adhering to it very much. There we go. Okay, now we do the mountains and the sky. The sky is going to be really fun because we're going to blot it off with the tissue. So first of all, let's put in a little dark in here. I've got a lot of water, so not really dark enough. I don't want this to stand out too much. Just a little bit. It's going to dry lighter, so it'll be fine. And right in here is slightly darker. Up here is slightly darker. There. And then up here is the most beautiful blue. This is almost pure blue. This little shape right here. Very bright. Almost blue-green. More of a blue-green. One little shape there. And then I'm going to add a little water to that. In the middle here, this is a little repeat of that, but it's lighter, too much water. So when you say you don't know how much water, this is how you do it. You start to put it on and you see that you have too much, that nothing's happening. That's probably about right. I'm comparing this value with that. So this is dark, medium. This over here is pretty much medium too. Put that in. And then there's some lovely little triangles, lines, things. You don't have to put too much in to tell the story. This is lighter than what's behind it. Kind of goes like that. This is a little triangle here. Keep it light. This is mostly just blue and green, these mountains here. I'm kind of keeping my eye on this 80% of the time, knowing that I'm not going to get it perfect. I don't want to get it perfect. I'm trying to make this loose and juicy. The only way I'm going to do that is to have some of it get away from me and not have too much control as I like. I think that's enough. Okay, so the mountains, I mean the sky really is mostly white, but to show you how to do the pick up the white cloud with the tissue, I'm gonna go ahead and put in the definite dark blues in here. There's a few blues in the sky. And I'll put the shadows in. The shadows, the definite shadows of them. There's a lovely little shape of a bird right there, kind of. I want to keep that and I want to keep this. But dark and definite. But the rest of it is just shadows. So let's take that blue and put in some shadows that I've indicated here. Could be enough. I just want to be sure that the clouds are the clouds above the mountain have to be pure white, otherwise they're not going to be different enough from the mountain. I'm making the mountains a little darker to solve that problem. So the mountains are darker than the sky for sure. Okay, I'm going to lift off a little bit here again. There we go. And then maybe back, get that line back. I like the sky like this. Okay, but I'm still going to show you how to do it. So I'm going to put a blue-green wash over the whole big area like this, and then blot it off with the tissue. Got to be pure white. I'm not going to be happy. So this you can just go like that. And this, look at the clouds that you're doing. And down here is all very white. Right? You have to do it fast because that's good. A little bit there. So we kind of lost our pure white, but we have some lovely shapes that you get from the tissue. So, but I'm going to lift a little bit off because I really want it to be pure white in some places. Okay. There. There we go. And maybe over here I won't do any. I'm gonna soften the edges because there isn't that many. Not that many shadows in here. Let's do that. Let's keep this. I mean, it's okay to play with that, but you really want to keep the whites. It's so important in this particular picture. Otherwise, the mountains aren't dark enough and all of our values will be off. So let's get back and look at it. Okay, one more thing. Just a little bit more accents in the shadows. Here. Okay, that is definitely fast. That was my plan. Fast, loose, and juicy, right? Exactly good. I'm done. Only thing is, this looks a little bit like a bird. That a little less important. Darken some of the other shadows before we stop. And while it's still wet, you can drop in all these little shadows and they'll blend right in. That's too much. Okay, I quit. Get back.
Add some more pink. Okay, here. I'm gonna spatter some more pink. Okay. All right, I'm in. Looking at it, I saw that I needed to define this line a little bit more, so I darkened it behind it with a little jagged line, which is more what we're looking at. And now I need to, I want to spatter it before I do anything. I want to spatter a little bit more. I spattered some green in here. But before it kind of bled out, but now that it's dry, the pink flowers will stand out more. Watch. See, this is a good opportunity. It works good with when it's wet, but then it also mostly fades out. So to put some paint in now while it's dry is a good idea. See, that really looks like flowers, doesn't it? And then I wanted to... There's a space right here where the land comes forward and the little mountain goes back. So I just fix that with a little bit of cobalt blue right in here. Probably not quite enough. Cobalt blue is a great color for these kinds of repairs. I'm putting that little line back there so that on the other side of the line is darker than what's up here. See, so now the land is coming at us more so right here too. So I feel better now. I think that's probably the best I can do. Maybe.
Oh, I forgot to tell you, I put all these, some of these dark lines down in here. Like one of the Van Gogh things, that I'll show you where he went back in and put a bunch of dark lines at the bottom. And I can see why he saw them. I see them now. So, that's it. Thank you.